Live with Mario Gaudino here from Weill Cornell University. I'm Gianluca Torregrossa from University of Chicago, and today I'm interviewing my dear friend Mario for his new book on technical aspects of coronary artery bypass grafting. Hi Mario, good morning.
Hello Gianluca, good morning. Thanks for having me. Thank you for the opportunity to discuss my book. Very happy to be here and very happy to see you in person, in video.
Yeah, it's our first live, so we are experiencing this new way of communicating, and we are asking all of the people that are looking at us through Periscope, through YouTube, and later on LinkedIn to use the comments option and to ask directly the author comments about the book, where to purchase, where to potentially how the energy is there. So Mario, let's start immediately. This is not your first published book, but I would say probably one of your most important experience as author of a book. Where the book or the idea of the book comes from?
Well, I need to be honest, Gianluca, I was approached by the publisher around a year ago. And they have this idea of a book on coronary artery bypass surgery. My first reaction, and this is my typical reaction when it comes to book, is that book about data, with all the due respect to those who publish them, have I don't think they are contemporary anymore. I mean, because of the speed of new information, the speed with whom scientific research move, because it takes almost a couple of years from the moment the book is written to the moment it's published. The risk with books about data is that they are outdated the moment they are out. So unfortunately, I am old enough to remember the pre-internet era. At that time, well, there was no PubMed, there was no Google. If you wanted to read about your specialty, you had to go to the library, and there was a gigantic book that was called Index Medicus, and you had to search to the Index Medicus. So at that time, specialty book may had a role, because you could see like it was not really up to date, but it was a very good summary of the current evidence in your field. But nowadays, this is not the case anymore. So in general, I'm not excited about books that report data. But I also said, I also told the publisher, I keep getting a question when I go at meetings and I make my presentation about technical aspects of coronary artery bypass surgery, which is the most commonly operation performed in adult cardiac surgery. So probably a book about the technical aspect of the operation could be an important contribution to the literature. But I also made clear to the publisher that I had two key requests: to have a large number of video and the strong support from illustrators, because a technical book is basically is like 90% based on picture and video. So I asked for a lot of support. I must say I got it. And what we have tried to do was a book that really guide you through the technical nuances of an operation that can be very easy, but can be also extremely complex and painful. So that was the idea, and yep, this is why we published the book.
When did you have this idea? When did you start? Like, how long does it take to build up a book like this? What is the journey? Tell us a little bit about, we are all youngsters dreaming about publishing a book. What is the headaches that comes from?
Well, you know me well, Gianluca, and you know I am a pain in the back. When I start and I want to do something, then I'm like the dog with the bone. I just keep pushing. And so I can tell you that it started exactly 1 year ago. I was at the AHA when I was approached by the publisher. And it was extremely fast for a book. I mean, I've been involved in book that took like 3 years, even 4 years to be published. It is really unusual to get a book published in 1 year, but I think there were two key issues in favor of the book in this situation. First of all, I already mentioned I am a pain, and second, the authors are all people that I know very well. They are all friends like you. And so, you know, I think they just put the assignment for the book very high in their list, and they got it done in time. But in general, for a book, 2 to 4 years is average. This is a relatively small book, but 1 year was really fast.
It was indeed, and as an author, I can share the experience.
The pain, yes, the pain. Yeah.
Frequent email to remind the deadlines and to respect them. And it's true. I mean, when you are a surgeon, you are request a lot of time to be part of these books, but then you lose track of that. In this was an experience, even as an author of the book, in which from the beginning of the engagement to the final acceptance was very fast, the entire process. So now, if I want to buy the book and I go online and I buy the book, which form of the book are available? And particularly because there are so many videos, what would you suggest for a potential buyer? To buy the hard copy, to buy the online, the Kindle, how can I see the videos once I buy the book?
Well, if you buy the electronic version, there is a link. If you buy the printed version, there are instructions of how to get to the link. I like the print version just because I am more used to reading on paper. I have heard many people that prefer the electronic version, so I don't think there is really any difference. I decided to have a relatively small format without hard cover to make the book relatively easy to transport and to read while you are going, I do not know, for example, at work or to keep in your office if you have a specific case and you want to refresh your memory about how to do things. Because the other key aspect of this book is that it's really, really technical. I mean, sometimes there are technical books that are just very vague in their description. Now, I asked everybody to really, really give tips and tricks, or how do you put your needle, what do you do if you have an hematoma on the mammary artery, which kind of retractor you want to you use for harvesting of the mammary, and what are the pro and the cons of each different retractor. So this is really, really a book that is intended to be in the surgeon's office, not so much in the surgeon's library, but really on the table of the surgeon office.
I see. So who, when you wrote the book, you were thinking for sure surgeons who perform coronary artery bypass grafting and give them technical aspects of this book. Who else are the potential recipients or buyers? So who would you suggest for this book is for?
So, well, I was mainly thinking of young surgeons, to be honest with you, because I had a lot of experience training young surgeons, and generally the training years are not enough to get, after your training, you have experience in standard CABG, not in modern CABG, like in the title of my book. So most of the young surgeon then learn how to perform more complex CABG when they are out in practice. They don't have a mentor in front of them. They don't have a senior partner that can teach them. So they were looking for guidance. And I have many of my former fellow that they keep calling me when they have cases and to ask about technical issues. So mostly that was intended for young surgeon or for surgeons that are not young anymore, but that they have interested in switching from mammary and vein to more complex form of revascularization. Yeah. Now, clearly, this is a book that may be of interest for anybody that is interested in the cardiovascular surgery field. So, I mean, I read the book about interventional cardiology just because I want to understand what my colleague next door are doing. So I wouldn't be shocked if some interventional cardiology would take a look at the book.
Yeah, I totally echoes your words. I think that the technical aspects are very important, not only for young surgeons and people interested in go above and beyond bypass surgery or perform 2.0 forms of bypass surgery, but there is also an important element in this era of translational medicine where more and more cardiac surgeon and interventional cardiologists has to work together. Interventional cardiologists, when they have to cath someone with a complex coronary bypass construct or a multiple arterial Y graft or T graft, they need to know what that should look like or what they are dealing with. So that will make it easier for them to perform a higher level of diagnostic cath or eventually interventional cath if needed.
This is very true, and every time in the average cath lab has to cath someone with a GIA, for example, it's yeah. It's panic. Nobody knows where is the GIA, where should I look for it. So yeah, this is a perfect example of something that we should both know, the interventional cardiologist and the cardiac surgeon.
Yeah. I agree. So this book represents somehow a push towards a new philosophy that you, together with few other surgeons in a very high level, are promoting to. This new philosophy is taking what we have considered always the bread and butter, coronary artery bypass grafting surgery, and try to improve the quality of the technical aspect in the procedure that we perform with the aim to deliver to a patient a better type of surgery and a better long-term result of what we do. Can you tell us a little bit where we stand at both in Europe, in United States, and in South America about this? And how much do you think this book will impact in incrementing the usage of multi-arterial bypass grafting and constructs?
Yeah, so you are 100% right. The attempt by people like John Puskas, David Taggart, Steve Frims has been for decades to improve the quality of the operation that we perform, and that has a huge implication because in the end, 60% of the patients that undergo cardiac surgery all around the world are in fact referred for coronary artery bypass surgery. So it is probably the intervention that has the most impact in terms of society and the long-term health consequence. Well, you know that the situation is very different in Europe, in the United States, and in Asia. I would say that the best quality of coronary surgery is probably performed in Asia. In Japan, Japan is the perfect example. Taiwan, they have they use routinely multiple arterial grafting. Most of the operations are performed on off pump. Intraoperative verification of quality of the graft is standard of care. In Europe, there has been a considerable improvement in the 90s and the early 2000s, and then things have plateaued a little bit. I would say that, again, there are variations between different countries, but probably around 30 to 35% of the patients referred for CABG received more than one arterial graft, which is the easiest of the quality metrics. In the United States, things are much less the surgical community is much more reluctant to use multiple arterial grafting. You know that we have shown that even in ideal candidate, young candidate, a low risk, the percentage of patient to receive more than one arterial grafting is in the single digit or in the 10-11%. So it is, there is still a lot of reluctance. And well, yeah, I guess the book can help, especially if a young surgeon find it interesting and start using at least multiple arterial grafting more often.
So Mario, let's say that I'm a young surgeon. I'm excited about coronary artery bypass grafting. I think that this is my niche and I want to establish or increase in the volume of bypass that are performed in my center, the use of multi-arterial or going through some of the aspects that you describe in the book, like techniques for YNT graft, how to harvest skeletonized mammary arteries with a harmonic scalpel, or how to construct complex arterial grafting. What do you think, what are the steps, or what is the first step and the last step in this in the journey of a dedicated, specialized coronary arterial or coronary arterial bypass graft surgeon? How do I implement my practice from on-pump CABG with one mammary and multiple veins to a high level or a 2.0 form of coronary artery bypass grafting surgery?
Well, that's a great question. It's also a very timely question because I think last week or 2 weeks ago, European Journal of Cardiothoracic Surgery published a paper from the ESCTS Task Force of Coronary Artery Bypass Surgery, where we clearly designed a step-by-step approach to go from mammary and vein to complex and more modern CABG, whatever that means. I think there are a few basic steps. To me, the key steps are the use of skeletonized mammary in every single case. So if you are out of practice and you want to do what you were asking, well, just start harvesting every single mammary skeletonized, even if you then are going to use mammary and vein. So you become familiar not only with the skeletonized technique, which is extremely important, I would say it's the foundation of the use of multiple arterial grafting, but also with a different concept of harvesting and also handling the conduit. So I see the routine use of skeletonization like a cultural change from a type of operation that is unfortunately generally considered, like you say, the bread and butter, so just fast and not necessarily delicate or accurate, to a different mindset where you treat your conduits with great respect and you try to have every single anastomosis as a perfect anastomosis, and there is a very limited room for sloppiness. And just by switching from the classical pedicle harvesting of a big fat pedicle of the mammary that many surgeons do in literally 5 minutes using the Bowie on 70 or 80 to a more delicate anatomic preparation like the skeletonization, that just help you in changing your mindset and your approach to the operation. The other key component is the use of the flow meter, the intraoperative flow meter, in every single case, even when you're doing mammary and vein. So you become familiar with the reading, with the methods, and the flow meter is, in my opinion, the coronary surgeon's best friend. The data are difficult to generate, but by personal experience, I can tell you that the flow meter gets you out of trouble more than anything else in the OR. But clearly, you need to know how to use it. So you need to start using it on every single case. After that, and at that stage, you, even though you're not doing multiple arterial grafting, you're already started your journey towards more complex and more modern CABG. You are using the flow meter, you skeletonize your mammary, then the very easy next step, instead of using a saphenous vein, start using the radial artery. The radial artery is extremely user-friendly, and to me, it's like the democratization of the use of multiple arterial grafting, because it allow the performance of MAG cases, even for surgeons who are not necessarily experienced or not been specifically trained. In the end, with few exceptions in terms of harvesting and indication, the radial artery is very similar to a vein. And I think those are the first step, and then you can start adding complexity to complexity. To me, the most beautiful operation is what Michael Valle has popularized, the anaortic all arterial CABG. But there is robotic, there is minimal invasive, and everybody will find one technique that he or she likes better than another.
I agree. I just want to disagree that the best, most beautiful coronary bypass surgery to perform is a multi-arterial bilateral off pump total robotic techniques. That's
sorry. I knew that was coming.
That's my choice. Yeah. So in this sense, I want to, one of the chapter of the book goes deeply into the trans-time flow meter assessment and how to read it. And I want to spend a little bit of time with you about TTM. This is a technology that surgeon really should embrace, but I do believe, and this is be a nice paper to publish too, if we ask to 100 of fellow or resident that just graduate from an I6 program in the United States, or a fellowship in cardiovascular or thoracic surgery, or a residency in Europe, and we will put them in front of five different flow meter assessment with PI, number, flows, and try to give them some option of when the bypass is open or closed, I do believe that most of them will fail in offering a proper analysis.
Yeah, that's possible.
What do you think is the best way to learn, and how do you approach the use of TTFM in your current practice? Do you do it in every type of surgery? What do you read? What is, like, you go more than flow and PI? How much do you give credit to the rest of the information that you can acquire?
Yes, so you are 100% right. People are not using the flow meter, at least not expert. Expert coronary surgeons are using it, but most of the people in the community are not using flow meter. I think we as a leader of coronary surgery have really made a mistake, and the mistake has been to make flow meter reading and interpretation so complicated. And so people at some moment just got scared or bored and didn't want to try or to use it. When I came at Cornell, and Cornell is a superb institution in terms of clinical excellence, but there was no flow meter. I mean, they didn't even know what the flow meter was. And now, 6 years later, there is no CABG that is performed, even when I'm not involved, where the flow meter is not used. And everybody, young attending resident and fellow, are very familiar with the reading of the flow meter. And I am extremely happy when I got a call from the OR, because one of my junior colleagues has some reading that the flow meter that he or she doesn't is not sure about and want to discuss with me, because that to me is the like the signal that there has been a cultural change, which is really something I'm very proud of. I personally measure at a different time. I think it's especially on pump, the amount of information that you can get from your the measurement you do while still on the arrested heart, so on pump with the cardioplegic arrest, are very valuable. especially in case of competitive flow. I mostly look at the shape of the curve. To me, this is the key information. That was how I was taught by Antonio Calafiore back in the days and Gabriele Di Gianmarco. And the shape of the curves is the most important information for me. I want to see a clear diastolic component, clearly off pump. On pump, I can just see, look at the flow. But off pump, I want to see a clear diastolic component. The PI and the flow are obvious important measure. They need to be stratified and adjusted based on the target vessel. I mean, the same flow, you cannot expect the same flow on a nice LED with a very proximal stenosis and a pristine distal runoff, and from a small PDA with a 70% stenosis and with diameter that is below 1 millimeter.
Do you stratify according to graft type? Do you expect a higher flow on vein, respect on radial, respect on artery, on mammary arteries, or RGA? Or do you, in your practice, do you see that the flow is only dependent among the coronary target and the distribution of the graft?
You know, I think this is just simple hydraulic, Gianluca. No, clearly, the aorta anastomosed graft have higher flow than in situ graft, just because it's a first order artery versus a third order artery, and for the GI fourth order artery. So sure, the immediate flow is higher for conduit anastomosed to the aorta, so the RITA freely anastomosed to the aorta will have a higher flow. The same RITA anastomosed to the same target, but in situ. And I don't think there is any difference between the radial artery and the saphenous vein, but keep in mind that I generally use saphenous vein from the lower leg. So the diameter of the saphenous vein that I use and the radial artery is more or less the same. The saphenous vein may be 1 or 2 millimeter larger. I don't use those big sausage from the thigh that some surgeon use, and maybe they may have a different flow, but I don't have a lot of experience with that.
I was extremely surprised and very positively interested in seeing that in such a technical book, your last chapter is written by Harold Lazar on optimizing medical therapy in the coronary bypass grafting. And I will say it's very interesting that it's almost a claim that surgeons should be involved in also the long-term outcomes of their work, that not only is measured inside the operative room, but also according to the therapy that these patients take. What's your insight about it, and how did it come out? When did you have this idea to include a medical therapy chapter in a technical book?
Well, it has always been part of my approach to CABG. Medical therapy is probably one of the most powerful weapon that we have in our armamentarium. And definitely we can increase the patency of our graft and the outcome of our patient with up-to-date secondary prevention. Unfortunately, we don't do that very often. We just forget about our patient after the first follow-up visit. All the CABG trial have shown that the percentage of patients who are taking secondary prevention medication based on current guideline, it's really, really low. It has been shown that the CABG PCI trial would have had better result for surgery if the surgical patient had the better strategy in terms of secondary prevention. Dr. Lazar has been interested in this particular field for decades. It's a good friend also. And he was in the book, in the list of the book order from day one. And I think this is something that every coronary surgeon should keep in mind.
Fantastic. So we have a question that comes from the pool here, and you can read, when should a trainee start devoting his or her career to coronary surgery as subspecialties? The sooner the better, or the latter the wiser?
Well, I don't have a very clear answer to that, because it really depends on the situation. I can tell you that I, for reasons that were independent of my willing, I was a coronary surgeon from day one, because when I started residency in my institution in Rome, the radial artery was just introduced. So I was assigned the study on the radial artery, and I kept working on the radial, and because of that, even when I grow and become an attending, most of the coronary cases were assigned to me. Then I was at that time in Rome, we had Professor Suma with us, and he was known for the pioneer work on the GIA. And then after that, I was sent to Chieti for 2 years to work with Antonio Calafiore. So it was just a coronary surgeon after coronary surgeon. That's why I become a coronary surgeon. In general, I think, well, you need to have a good understanding of what is cardiac surgery in general. I don't think that a coronary surgeon should have no experience in non-coronary stuff. I can do a type A if he came in. It's just not my practice. And I think this is what the average coronary surgeon should be able to do. Probably immediately after training, so after you had had the general exposure to all the different aspects of cardiac surgery, and you can manage the basics, if you like coronary surgery in particular, then coronary, you should be thinking of super fellowship or specific training. I was privileged to train a lot of young surgeons, and many of them are now much better than me. I think you can see a coronary surgeon, if someone can be a good coronary surgeon from the get-go. This is a surgery that really requires an extreme attention to details. It's not about speed, it's not about being like a write in the book, at lunch break before your colleague next door. It is about perfection of the technical component of your job. And when I always tell my fellow, my clinical fellow, there is one and only way to put a stitch in a coronary anastomosis, and it is the right way. There is no other acceptable way of doing it. And so if you have that mindset, I think you may be a good coronary surgeon. I think, I am a man, so I have not direct experience, but in general, I think women are probably better coronary surgeons than men. In my experience, my trainee, I had some women in training that were really, really fantastic technically. Probably they are more focused, they pay more attention to details, they don't have that idea of being the fastest in the OR, and it is something that I have definitely found that may be particularly appealing for women who decided to do in cardiac surgery.
Okay, thank you so much. So before completing this live, I would like to have some fast answers about technical aspects. So Mario Gaudino, patient comes to you from out of state to get multi-arterial bypass grafting, 56 years old, stable coronary artery disease, tight stenosis or CTO or 90% of the right left main disease with two good targets for the OM and a big important LAD. What is the way in which, in from a technical aspects, generally, I mean, of course, everyone has, like, you personalize the surgery for the according to the angiography, but how, what is your preference in terms of graft? Where do you deploy what? What do you use? How do you use the Rita? How do you take it down your mammary arteries? And how do you generally perform this surgery?
Well, that's a million-dollar question, but to give you some, at least some concept, mammary are always skeletonized, even if I'm doing mammary and vein. My second arterial conduit is generally the right internal thoracic artery, except in diabetics, and for patient above 70 years of age. Above 70 years of age, my default conduit is the my default arterial conduit is the radial artery. In younger patient, the radial artery is generally my third arterial conduit if there is reason to perform total arterial revascularization. I may change the order, and I prefer the radial rather than the Rita if I have to perform multiple anastomoses, like sequential anastomosis, of if the dust, the target vessel are very distal, because in this case I found the radial artery more surgeon friendly, and that allow a more complete revascularization. I have no problem in using the right ITA as a free graft. I think it is something that every surgeon should consider. There is this legend that it doesn't work, or it is associated with a higher rate of occlusion. The RAPCO trial has shown excellent patency rate for free Rita at the 10 year. It's just an anastomosis that need to be done with some keeping in mind some technical detail that are very clearly highlighted in the book. But definitely there are situations where a free Rita is better than an inside Rita.
Do you land your free Rita on a piece of vein for your proximal anastomosis?
No. Don't say that. No. Just in the aorta. No.
The aorta. What do you use? 7-0, 6-0?
I use a 3.2 or 3.6 punch at the 7-0 proline, and then I make my arteriotomy probably 30 to 40% larger than the all in the aorta. And then it's just a standard technique.
Okay. And that's it. I think I was very impressed by the book. I have to be honest. I really read it with a lot of interesting. I think that there's a lot of minute and very technical elements that was the philosophy behind the book itself. So I found it extremely useful to read. And I think that will be very useful for a lot of other readers. And it was really a pleasure to have you here today and to discuss this book with you. Thank you so much, Mario. And we'll see soon all of our... Oh, we have one more question here from Umberto. Would you use arterial grafting in the context of very poor left ventricle?
No. No, you know, the benefit for multiple arterial grafting is seen only in the long term. Now we have... more and more convincing evidence that the key determinant when deciding the operative strategy should be patient life expectancy. If you don't live enough to see the benefit of multiple arterial grafting, there is no reason. And Umberto, the one that is asking the question, has published a seminal meta-analysis showing that the difference in patency rate between artery and vein becomes significant after the fourth postoperative year. So in the setting of a poor left ventricle of a patient with limited life expectancy, I don't think the average surgeon should use multiple arterial grafting. Now, if it is a young surgeon, a young patient, and the surgeon is experienced, the radial artery may be considered. But keep in mind that if the patient will require a high dose of vasopressors postoperative, that may be an issue. So, I mean, the enemy of good is perfect, as you know.
Absolutely. I have actually, in this sense, one comment to say. And I will say, when you work in a center that is really accustomed for multi-arterial grafting, it comes almost easier to take out a radial, or at the same level, to take out a radial rather than a vein. And I found in some patients, the quality of the vein to be extremely poor. And you can predict that even before surgery. So independently from age, happened to me that I prefer a second arterial conduit, even in an 80-year-old patient or in a 75 that doesn't really have that expectancy of life that would benefit for a second arterial grafting, but choosing only to favor a conduit that is less likely to be dilated or to do not be appropriate in size. This is when you start to use and to adopt multi-arterial grafting is something to consider in that sense as well.
Yeah, I mean, that is true, Angeluca, but also do not forget that there are patient population where you can have a radial artery that is not usable. My experienced patient with renal failure of patient with aggressive vasculopathy may have a calcification of the radial artery to the point that the artery is not adequate for grafting. So it's always a balance, and in the end, the strategy needs to be individualized to the single patient.
We have one more question. Now that we were about to close, it's a very interesting question that are popping up. And here there is, do you think the third arterial conduit influence the long-term outcome?
Well, there is no evidence of that. What we have, it's just based on observational study that clearly have a strong treatment allocation bias with the best patient, the patient with the longer life expectancy receiving total arterial revascularization. There is a biologic rationale because arterial conduits have better patency rate. Now, if that patency rate translate in better clinical outcome, we are not sure. So the bottom line is that, Gianluca, if you can add a third arterial graft without increasing your operative mortality, you should probably do it. But if you are concerned that you're not at that stage of experience where adding a third arterial graft is without any price to pay, well, you shouldn't probably use it.
Fantastic. And here another question from Mariano. How do you define incomplete revascularization? Do not bypass a lesion?
Well, we can discuss that forever. There are anatomical definitions, there are functional definitions. I personally tend to graft every coronary territory with significant stenosis. I do not think that leaving, for example, an OM2 when you do an OM1 is the same that leaving a whole territory ungrafted. So I would say that I generally go by territory. And but again, a lot has been written about that, and I don't think we have time to discuss the issue of FFR for CABG, but that is a very important story that would probably deserve a separate interview.
One more technical question, and then just we wait for one more question from the floor, the panels, and then we can end the broadcast. But this is something we have discussed privately about left internal mammary artery in a dialyzed patient with a fistula on the left arm. How do you behave, and what is your preference?
I use a free mammary. Actually, I would use a free Rita, not a free Lita. The reason I would use a free Rita is because proximally the Rita is slightly larger than the Rita, and so that would make my aortic anastomosis easier. We publish on circulation that in some patients, not all patients, but in some patients who have a left internal thoracic artery, 2D LAD, and AV fistula on the arm, ipsilateral to the Lita, there may be some steal from the coronary circulation when the patient undergo dialysis. So this is an option. This is a risk I do not want to take because it become a really complex situation to fix. I mean, you have no other option rather than going back and putting that lita to, on the aorta, or you have to basically refer a patient to PCI, like if surgery was not done. So my default operation in this case is to use a free rita to the LAD.
Okay, that's a very, I was very surprised when you told me, and actually was very inspiring to me, because this is our things that happen in our clinical daily life, and we generally go for a default lima to LAD. So it's very interesting to know your opinions, and as always, your opinion is based on a study and scientific attitude behind it. So I want to really thank you again. This is the real end of our broadcast. And I will suggest everybody to take a deep look and a strong consideration in purchasing this book that will answer all of the questions that we have not covered during this live broadcast. Thanks again, Mario. Thank you for your time. And thanks to everybody who have participated with questions from Periscope and from YouTube and LinkedIn. Thank you.
Thank you, Gianluca. It was great.